안녕하세요. 아마존 웹서비스의 염동훈입니다. 반갑습니다. 바쁘신 와중에도 2017년 서울 서밋을 참여해주신 여러분께 진심으로 감사드립니다. 저희가 이 행사를 지난 3년 동안 이제 계속 해왔는데 올해 처음으로 저희가 이틀 연속 행사를 이제 진행합니다. 그래서 보시다시피 그 2일 동안 만 명 이상이 신청을 했습니다. 그래서 총 6천 명 이상이 이제 참가를 할 거라고 저희는 보고 있고요. 어제만 봐도 저희가 첫날에 4천여 명이 이제 참가를 했었고, 그리고 35개의 세션, 그러니까 산업별로 저희가 세션을 이제 진행했었습니다. 그래서 뭐 금융 쪽, 뭐 미디어, 그리고 다양한 어떤 업종에서 여러 세션을 진행하면서 또 그 세션에서는 뭐 저희가 직접 하는 것보다도 같이 저희 고객들과 고객 사례 중심으로 세션들을 진행했습니다. 그래서 오늘도 저희가 상당히 많은 세션들이 오후에 또 오전부터 오후까지 이제 준비가 되어 있고요. 다양한 고객들이 여러분들과 어떻게 지금 AWS를 사용해서 본인들의 사업을 재혁신을 하고 있는지, 아니면 신규 사업을 준비를 하고 있는지 그 내용을 여러분과 같이 공유할 겁니다. 제가 느끼기에 지금 많은 분들이 이렇게 관심을 보여주고 있는 이유는 지금 상당히 큰 변화가 있습니다. 아마 여러분들도 상당히 많이 그걸 느끼고 계실 것 같다는 생각이 드는데요. 이런 변화 속에서는 뭐 당연히 위기도 있지만 확실히 또 새로운 기회가 나타날 거라고 봅니다. 그래서 그런 기회를 여러분들이 잘 찾아서 성공적으로 누구보다 더 빨리 시장을 개척해 나가면서 포지셔닝을 잘 하시게 되면은 미래에 큰 성공을 할 수 있다고 저는 봅니다. 그래서 이런 미래의 어떤 기회를 찾기 위해서는 어떻게 보면 지금 우리가 보고 있는 큰 메가 트렌드 몇 가지를 여러분들이 관심을 갖고 보셔야 된다고 봅니다. 그 메가 트렌드라는 것은 당연히 클라우드가 그 중에 하나이고요. 근데 이제 클라우드를 통해서 지금 AI나 빅데이터, IoT 이런 큰 분야에서 상당히 많은 변화가 있고 기회가 있습니다. 그래서 이런 새로운 메가 트렌드를 사용해서 지금 하고 계신 어떤 사업들을 어떻게 다시 한번 재혁신을 할까? 그래서 미래에 어떻게 다시 우리가 좀 더 성공을 크게 할 수 있을까? 그런 고민을 하셔야 됩니다. 근데 이제 여러분들의 고민을 혼자 하는 것보다도 저희가 어떻게 도움을 드릴 수 있을까? 그런 생각을 하면서 저희가 첫 번째로 한 게 작년 16년에 1월 달에 그 한국의 데이터 센터, 저희는 이제 리전이라고 부릅니다. 그래서 리전을 시작을 했습니다. 그 다음에 리전을 개설 이후 상당히 많은 서비스를 지속적으로 저희가 추가를 하면서 여러분들이 AWS 플랫폼의 힘을 통해서 여러분들이 하고자 하는 사업을 저희가 열심히 뒷받침을 하고 있습니다. 그래서 상당히 다양한 규모의 고객들이 AWS 통해서 지금 사업을 진행하고 있습니다. 뭐 당연히 스타트업이나 게임 회사들은 처음부터 클라우드가 처음 나왔을 때부터 처음부터 이렇게 열심히 저희가 제공하고 있는 뭐 탄력성, 안정성, 보안성 이런 걸 잘 사용을 하면서 사업을 성공적으로 계속하고 있고요. 최근에 들어와서는 금융, 리테일, 뭐 미디어 회사들 또 대기업들이 그 똑같은 클라우드가 제공하는 장점들을 사용하면서 지금 사업을 펼쳐나가고 있습니다. 근데 제가 이제 말씀드리고 싶은 거는 이제 이런 그 새로운 변화 속에서 이 새로운 트렌드를 사용을 해갖고 새로운 사업을 할 때 이게 쉽진 않죠. 쉽지가 않기 때문에 여러분들이 혼자 한다는 것보다도 그렇게 생각하지 마시고 AWS에서 도움을 드릴 수 있는 부분, 저희가 뭐 같이 일을 하고 있는 저희 팀들이 있습니다. 그래서 어카운트 담당하는 팀들도 있고 그 기술적인 부분에서 도움을 주고 있는 솔루션스 아키텍트 팀이 따로 있고, 그 다음에 만약에 이제 저희 그 플랫폼 위에서 서비스를 이미 하고 계시면은 문제 없이 서비스가 잘 운영될 수 있도록 도움을 주고 있는 엔터프라이즈 서포트 팀이 있습니다. 또한 뭔가 새로운 것을 이제 시작을 할 때 초기 단계에 컨설팅이 필요하면은 저희 그 컨설팅 팀이 이제 도움을 드릴 수도 있고, 근데 더 중요한 거는 상당히 많은 파트너들이 준비가 돼 있습니다. 여러분들을 돕기 위해서. 아마 밖에서 이제 그 보셨을 거라고 생각하는데 상당히 다양한 지금 부스가 준비가 돼 있습니다. 그게 다 저희랑 같이 열심히 일을 하고 있는 파트너들이 준비한 부스이고요. 그래서 시간이 있으시면은 꼭 한번 방문을 해 주시면 좋을 것 같습니다. 상당히 많은 그 파트너들이 지금 저희랑 같이 이 행사를 위해서 열심히 마련한 거기 때문에 시간을 갖고 꼭 방문해 주시면 감사하겠습니다. 제가 어저께 그 키노트를 이제 준비하면서 그 데이 원이라는 말씀을 드렸습니다. 그 참석하신 여러분들, 뭐 어제 참석하신 여러분들은 이제 이 내용을 알고 계실 텐데 제가 다시 한번 여러분들한테 그 말씀드리고 싶은 거는 저희 회사에서 데이 원이라는 말을 잘 사용합니다. 특히 최근에 그 창업자 겸 CEO이신 제프 베조스가 주주들한테 편지를 쓰면서 데이 원이라는 뜻이 무엇이다, 왜 그게 우리한테 중요하다, 그 얘기를 하셨습니다. 저는 뭐 쉽게 얘기해서는 항상 초심을 잃지 않고 저희가 열심히 여러분들의 성공을 위해서 일을 해야 된다. 또 저희들도 나름대로 좀 어떻게 보면 절박감을 갖고 계속 새로운 사업 기회를 만들어내야 된다. 근데 어떻게 보면은 아마 여러분들도 이제 비슷한 철학이나 비슷한 정신을 갖고 사업을 하고 계실 거라고 믿는데요. 그래도 한번 뭐 아마존에서는 지금 어떻게 생각을 하면서 일을 하고 있는지 그게 관심 있으시면은 그 제프 베조스가 작성한 주주 편지를 한번 보시면은 도움이 될 거라고 저는 봅니다. 오늘 그 키노트를 해주실 에이전 카크로프트 AWS에서 클라우드 아키텍터를 지금 담당하고 있는 부사장입니다. 그래서 그 부사장님을 모시고 데이투 키노트를 시작하겠습니다. 큰 박수 부탁드립니다.
Hi everyone. Thanks for spending the day with us here in Seoul. Well, I was last in Seoul more than 10 years ago. I was a specialist in performance, capacity planning, and agile development. And I was an expert in building scalable systems. And about 10 years ago, I joined a small company called Netflix. And Netflix at the time was just launching its streaming service, and I joined to help build out their product, and eventually I became their cloud architect. Now, in 2009, Netflix was running out of data center capacity. The streaming service was growing so fast that we couldn't keep up. And we went to talk to AWS, and we asked them, could we run a really large company on AWS? And we found out together. Netflix was really the first all-in customer of AWS. We worked together to define what that meant and all of the different services we needed and support we needed to run Netflix at scale on AWS. Today, Netflix runs on over 100,000 instances. They scale up and down by more than 10,000 instances every day. And they still fit on AWS. This was very important to Netflix, that AWS grew faster than Netflix needed them to grow. There's a story here. You want to be a small fish in a big pond. You don't ever want to be a shark in a paddling pool. You have to fit. So it's very important that we look at how fast AWS is growing to make sure that the largest companies around the world can see the cloud as an elastic capacity and not run out of space. So I'm going to give you some details now on AWS and how we have capacity for our customers to grow. We now have a $14 billion revenue run rate and grew 47% year on year. Have millions of active customers every month. And AWS is the fastest growing multi-billion dollar enterprise IT company in the world. We have the largest number of startup customers. And about 3 years ago, I left Netflix and I began working for a venture capital firm. We looked at thousands of companies over almost 3 years. Every company we invested in was running on AWS. Nobody wants to build their own capacity. And we invested in many companies that help people move to cloud. On the right side here, you can see some companies locally here in Korea. 80% of the top Korean startups are using cloud. And the top 15 gaming companies in Korea are using AWS cloud, including Nexon, Netmarble, and NCSoft. The other group of customers I spoke to when I was at the venture capital firm were enterprise customers. They wanted to find out how to sell products from our startups into enterprise, and I spent a lot of time with large companies globally. And these customers were also making a large move to AWS at the time. I spent a lot of time just talking to them, and this was what led me to join AWS about 5 months ago. My role at AWS is to spend a lot of time talking to our customers, whether startups or huge enterprises, and to find out how they use our products and what we need to do next to service their needs. AWS runs on customer obsession. We have to know what our customers are doing, and I'm part of the team that figures out how to take that insight and decide what things we want to do next. In Korea, you can see here, we have Samsung Electronics and LG Electronics, the top three broadcasting companies in Korea, and many retail companies as well. Public sector is an interesting area. Many government departments are finding that their existing IT systems are too slow, too cumbersome, and too expensive. Back in 2010, there was a paper written in the UK called Better for Less. It set out a new way of doing IT, which became a template for the UK government digital service. That was also copied in the US and in other countries. We're now seeing large-scale government projects being built for a tiny fraction of the cost and a tiny fraction of the time. The other side of public sector is around education. Many large universities globally are working with AWS, and tens of universities have joined the AWS Educate program in Korea, including Songgang University, Seoul National University, and Like a Lion, which is a nonprofit for coding education. One of the recurring themes I see as I talk with executives that are moving to cloud is that they are looking for expertise to help them make that move. It's hard to find people with a lot of experience in a new area, but we have a consulting and an ecosystem of consulting partners who can help you. And we've invested in this. We have a very large, some of the largest consulting partners in the world. And in Korea, we have Megazone and GS Neotech, who are also sponsoring this conference. The cloud exists to run applications, and we have the broader system of ISVs as well, providing solutions for every market, including Samsung SDS for logistics service and TMacSoft and database service. This is key, both on-premise, on applications you install to move from your on-premise installations to cloud, and also for applications that you run, you consume as SaaS products. So what do the analysts say? AWS is positioned as a leader in the Gartner Magic Quadrant. It has been the leading cloud platform for many years, according to Gartner, and we're many times the aggregate size of other players in the market. So where are we now in the cloud evolution? In 2014, cloud became the new normal. In 2015, we gave you control over your own destiny. And in 2016, we started to talk about superpowers. We want to give you the superpowers that will let you do things that you never thought were possible. I'm going to go through several of these superpowers, but if you think about James Bond, James Bond goes out and saves the world, has a great time, but he has Q as his backup, providing him with the fastest cars, with the best weapons, with the best communication systems. We want to be Q so that you can be the hero, you can be James Bond. I'm going to start by talking about supersonic speed. When we talk to our customers, this is usually the number one reason that they want to move to cloud. It's agility, it's the speed, the ability to get things done really quickly. It gives you the capability to get thousands of machines in minutes instead of weeks or months. We have a huge number of applications and services. It takes a long time just to look at this slide. I'm going to concentrate on one thing on this slide, and then we'll go through and talk about some more in detail. The second row here is the marketplace. AWS customers use over 300 million hours a month running marketplace applications. The marketplace grew 112% from last year. So if you're an ISV or an application builder, you can build your product, you can put it in our marketplace, whether it's a pre-built image or it's a SaaS application. And this provides customers with the ability to discover your application. As we get more and more applications, it's becoming hard to know what is even possible because there is so much choice. The marketplace gives us a way for you to find one application and then find related applications and to discover things you didn't even know that were possible. We have more than 3,500 software listings from more than 1,000 ISVs. The reason we have so many things on the previous slide is that we've been developing at an accelerating pace. Last year, we launched over 1,000 new features, new capabilities. That's more than 3 a day. The year before, 722. You can see that we're accelerating. As AWS gets bigger, we're able to build more things for more people and solve more problems for our customers. If you think about trying to catch up with somebody who is accelerating away from you, it's very hard. We think we have a substantial lead, and we think that it is a growing lead. Many of our customers agree with us. The services we have deep functionality. If you look at the security and access space, we can audit the use of keys, which is useful for compliance purposes. In the network side, we've recently came out with very extensive IPv6 support, which is important particularly to mobile providers. And we have a huge range of compute services. I'm going to spend a bit more time talking about our compute services. In particular, the LightSail product is a very simple to use virtual private server. If you just want to stand up a website, you don't want to think too hard about all of the other services, I mean, the AWS console has a lot of functionality on it. LightSail has a specific console, makes it easy to set up. It has an easy pricing model, and it's a very simple product with everything bundled in. This is an easy on-ramp if you just wanted to stand up a WordPress blog or something similar like that, the virtual private server. The i3 is a particularly interesting product. The i2, the previous product we had for doing high-end I/O, did 300,000 IOs per second, more than 300,000 IOs per second on a single instance. We thought that was fast. I thought that was fast. The i3 is over 3 million IOs on a single instance. If you build an array of these into a data store, it's incredible performance, really extreme. And it was launched in Seoul in February. You know, we announced the product in December, and it's great to see that the Seoul region get access to it only a few months later. We also have the P2, a general purpose GPU. This is an incredibly powerful instance. If you go to your data center management in your company and say, I'd like access to a machine that has 16 GPUs on it and 700 gigabytes of RAM, just for a few hours to play around with something and see if I can train this deep learning model, you're not going to get a great experience. It's an incredibly powerful machine. You typically need it for a short period of time to train a deep learning model. You don't need to have a bank of them running for many weeks. Because the toolkits we provide are scalable, you can use several P2s together to take something that might take you a month to train to maybe do it in a few hours. And of course, the P2 was launched in Seoul last week. I also want to talk about the X1. The X1 came out of a partnership with SAP. They need terabytes of memory to run their SAP HANA data store. It's an in-memory data store. But we didn't just make a special deal to produce hardware for a single purpose. Anybody can access the X1. And again, if you go to your operations team and say, I need a machine with 2 terabytes of memory and 128 cores, it's hard to get those machines. It's hard to do experiments. This is the superpower that we're giving you, the ability to get access to machines and capacities that you've never been able to get before. You can get them in a few minutes. You can use them for a few hours. You can do experiments, proof of concept. You can try things that have never been done before. And then you can give them back, and you can do it for a very small amount of money. Now, we have some really extreme customizability now. The F1 instance, which was announced last December, is now available, generally available. That was announced in the San Francisco summit earlier today. What can you do with this? Well, in Korea, I know you have a lot of people that are very good hardware designers. The F1 is a field programmable gate array based instance. A hardware designer, somebody that knows how to design gates and lay them out on a chip, they can come in and figure out to use the same tools to program the F1 to have a custom accelerator on it. We can use this for genomics, for signal processing, image processing, some special kinds of deep learning. It's really an incredible capability, and it's very specialized. The rest of you who aren't hardware designers, well, maybe it's not so useful to be able to program these. But using the AWS Marketplace, we're able to take the designs produced by the specialists who can design hardware and make those available. So if you're a hardware designer, you can come up with a special purpose processor on the F1. You can publish that to the marketplace, and anybody can then use that, and you get credited. We pay you through the marketplace. So we have some amazing capabilities that are just starting to launch here. The program is really exciting, and the designers in this space have never found such easy access to the ability to create hardware designs. Finally, Elastic GPUs were announced at reInvent in December. This lets you add a GPU to any instance type. You can attach it dynamically and say, for this instance, I want to have a GPU. I have the right combination of CPU and memory for most of my application, but I want to have a GPU for graphics acceleration or for deep learning training. Okay, we have many customers that we have helped achieve supersonic speed. And I'd like to talk a bit about LG. They use AWS to support the smart TV service. 35 million LG smart TVs across the globe are running using AWS at the back end. And I have to tell you a little story. Maybe 6-7 years ago, when I was working at Netflix, I would walk through one section of the building where they were working on consumer electronics. And maybe people don't realize, but LG and Samsung were the first real partners for Netflix in digital TV. Really strategic, critical partners that made Netflix, the important part of what made Netflix successful today came out of that partnership. It was very early, and the idea that you would stream internet to your TV was still a new idea. I would walk past these TVs, and there was one TV, I liked this TV, it looked very nice, and I made a note of the number on the back of the TV, and I added it to my Amazon wish list. A few months later, my existing TV stopped working. Push the button and I have a 60-inch LG TV living in my house ever since. Great combination. Now I'd like to bring up another customer that we have helped bring supersonic speed to media adoption with the Korean broadcasting company ABS. Please welcome Mr. Park Dong-uk, Director of KBS Digital Service, to the stage.
Good KBS 한국 방송에서 디지털 서비스를 총괄하고 있는 박동욱입니다. 오늘 AWS 서밋을 통해서 그간 아마존과 KBS 간의 협업의 결과를 공유하게 되어서 기쁘게 생각합니다. KBS는 1TV, 2TV, 두 개의 TV 채널, 그리고 7개의 라디오 채널, 그리고 월드방송, 6개의 케이블 채널, 그리고 오는 5월 31일부터는 전 세계에서 최초로 UHD 방송을 시작하게 됩니다. KBS는 실시간 TV, VOD를 중심으로 하는 MyK 어플리케이션, 그리고 실시간 라디오, AOD 서비스를 중심으로 하는 콩, 그리고 기타 어플리케이션, 웹페이지를 통해서 KBS의 풍부한 컨텐츠를 공급하고 있습니다. 그런데 KBS는 최근에 컨텐츠 소비 시장의 급격한 변화, 즉 공급자 중심에서 소비자 중심으로 바뀌는 컨텐츠 소비 행태를 디지털 모바일 영역에서 구현하고자 고민해 왔습니다. 작년에 공전의 히트를 기록한 태양의 후예, 최고 시청률이 38.8%, TV를 통해서 이 드라마가 방영될 시간이면 TV는 물론 디지털 모바일 서비스에 엄청난 많은 사람들이 몰려왔습니다. 순간 트래픽이 저희가 IDC 기반의 서버로 감당할 수 없을 정도로 공전의 히트를 기록했습니다. 태양의 후예와 같이 예측 가능한 트래픽을 예상할 수 있으면 다행입니다. 하지만 오른쪽에 보신 것처럼 작년 9월 12일 우리나라 기상 관측 사상 가장 큰 지진이 경주에서 있었습니다. 아시다시피 KBS는 재난방송 주간사입니다. 재난 사태가 알려졌을 때 많은 분들이 KBS 사이트로 접근을 했습니다. 아쉽게도 순간적이나마 저희 서비스가 원활치 않았습니다. 이처럼 드라마 또는 예능, 기타 다양한 컨텐츠는 물론이고 예측 불가능한 지진, 재해에 대해서 KBS는 재난방송 주관사로서 준비를 해야만 했습니다. 그래서 KBS는 어떻게 다양한 그리고 한 시점에 몰리는 트래픽을 안전하게 서비스를 할 것인가 고민한 끝에 AWS를 선택했습니다. AWS, 단순히 클라우드 시스템이 아니라 급변하는 모바일 환경에 새로운 기술, 새로운 비즈니스 모델 등을 수용할 수 있는 90가지가 넘는 서비스가 함께하는 솔루션입니다. 이를 통해서 KBS는 방송 콘텐츠를 디지털 모바일로 보다 편하게, 안전하게 서비스하기 위한 플랫폼을 준비하게 됐습니다. 지난 3월부터 내부에서 베타 테스트를 하고 있는 새로운 서비스를 AWS 플랫폼을 AWS 지원을 통해서 약 4개월 동안 준비한 서비스입니다. 곧 상용화를 앞두고 있습니다. 눈이라는 브랜드를 붙였고요. 여기에는 실시간 뉴스, 라이브, VOD는 물론이고 걸어서 세계 속으로라는 가장 KBS의 대표적인 여행 프로그램을 중심으로 여행 버티컬, 생로병사의 비밀이라는 의학 프로그램을 중심에 두고 건강정보를 모은 건강 버티컬, 그리고 1967년부터 지금까지 TV CF를 아카이브된 파일에서 꺼내서 한국의 CF 역사를 한꺼번에 조망할 수 있는 CF 등의 서비스를 준비해 왔습니다. KBS와 아마존 간의 협업은 여기서 멈추지 않습니다. 아마존의 고도화된 빅데이터 분석 툴 등을 활용해서 앞으로 KBS는 모든 분에게 똑같은 서비스를 제공하는 것이 아니라 개인화된 맞춤 서비스를 기획하고 있습니다. 이 같은 노력이 KBS 콘텐츠를 공급자 중심에서 소비자 중심으로 바꾸는 큰 힘이 되고 있습니다. 마지막으로 KBS의 클라우드 전략에 대해서 간략히 말씀드리겠습니다. 저희는 올해 말까지 기존 서버 플랫폼을 아마존의 클라우드 플랫폼으로 이전을 목표로 하고 있습니다. 그리고 그게 완료가 되면 빅데이터 분석 및 추천 시스템을 통해서 개인화 서비스를 고도화할 예정입니다. 마지막으로 미디어 저장소 및 인코딩 플랫폼을 완벽하게 클라우드 시스템으로 이전하면 앞으로 새롭게 변화될 디지털 모바일 서비스에 보다 능동적 대응이 가능할 거라고 생각합니다. 아마존이 마련한 이 서밋을 통해서 여러분의 앞선 경험을 많은 참가자하고 나누실 소중한 기회가 되시기를 바랍니다. 그리고 변화되는 KBS 디지털 서비스에 대한 아낌없는 성원을 부탁드리면서 제 발표를 마치겠습니다. 감사합니다.
감사합니다. Thanks, Mr. Park. So, excellent to see a wonderful case of fast adoption and mass migration in a traditional broadcasting company. I'm going to talk a bit now about another superpower, X-ray vision, the ability to see inside your data. It's never been easier to get incredible analytics at high speed on enormous amounts of data. I'm going to tell you some of the capabilities that we provide you in this space. The first place I will talk about is looking backwards, historical views of your data. Use Redshift to build data warehouses, QuickSight for business intelligence and visualization, and Athena to do ad hoc queries against S3. Athena was announced at reInvent in 2016. It has some really interesting capabilities. You just leave your data in S3. It doesn't matter if your data is encrypted or it's compressed. You can run queries on it directly. So that's historical data. We also want to do real-time data science. And we have amazing capabilities with Hadoop and the Hadoop ecosystem of tools, Hadoop, Spark, Hive, Presto. EMR is a packaged mechanism for running Hadoop. I was actually back at Netflix in 2008, one of the first users of Hadoop. My team stood it up as on a cluster, a small cluster, and we found it was a little hard to run, but very powerful. Then we heard that AWS was providing EMR, the ability to launch Hadoop cluster with a simple API call or a click on the console. And since 2009, I've never had a problem creating a Hadoop cluster. And I hear over and over again with other customers, the people running Hadoop themselves, oh, it's a big, difficult problem keeping Hadoop running and configuring it. Well, it's one click. It's one API call. A few minutes later, a large Hadoop cluster appears. We like to make things easy. Now, for real-time streaming of data, we want to use Kinesis, which gives us the ability to process the logs as they're the events as they come through, and Elasticsearch for real-time indexing and search of these data and dev log files. So that gives you historical views, the ability to generate real-time analytics, but we also want to predict the future. For that, we have Amazon Machine Learning. You can train the machine learning tool to spot patterns in your data and to give you insights on what might be happening next. Let's look a bit more at Athena. We can query S3 directly with the data in any format. You don't have to create instances and move the data in. You just give it the SQL query, and then you get your result back. The results come back in seconds, even for really large queries. And you pay for just the queries you run. This is a serverless approach to data science. Athena will be available in the Seoul region in the next few weeks. So you'll all be able to use it locally. It's been available in the US for a few months now. So we have different tools for different jobs. Redshift for data warehousing on huge data sets where we have very structured queries and the kind of queries you use for running your business with weekly reports, business intelligence. We have EMR for doing analytics against large data sets for exploratory data analysis in particular and real time. And we have Athena for making sense of your archive data in whatever format you've kept it. We have many customers who are using AWS to achieve X-ray vision. In particular, I want to mention Samsung, who are using EMR to process logs from billions of mobile devices. And IGA Works, a mobile advertising company, using Kinesis to analyze real-time logs from 200 million mobile devices. But I started talking about machine learning. And this is the power of precognition, the ability to see into the future and make sense of it. Amazon.com, the wider company, has been using machine learning for many years. They use it for demand forecasting, for recommendations of what product you might want to buy. They use it for visual search, fraud analysis. There are many, many uses, and there are thousands of people at Amazon who have been doing machine learning for many years. We wanted to take this capability and bring it to our customers. So on AWS, we have some new capabilities, and we have many customers now using machine learning on AWS. In particular, Huddle. This is a predictive analytics package on sports. Think about maybe you play soccer or American football or lacrosse. There are these games being played in high schools, in local teams, semi-professional teams, and even unprofessional. It would be interesting if you could analyze all the different plays, if you were a coach. How are people playing? This is what they do. You take video of the game, you upload the video, and Huddle has over 130,000 customers using this. That's a huge number of teams. They upload 35 hours of video every minute at peak time. They process the video, they do machine learning and analytics in order to discover which are the key plays, and then you can go and review those with the team and make the team better. This is a really interesting application. For Netflix, the recommendation engine is something I worked on while I was there. When you watch a movie, we want to recommend what additional movies might you want to see, and how are they similar, and what is the most likely thing you will do next when you've watched a piece of content. Many applications here. So how are we building this into products for AWS? We have the machine learning product that's been out now for a few years. We also have a deep learning AMI and template. This lets you take the standard packages that everyone is using in this space. This is the bleeding edge, the best software in the world for doing deep learning. All the packages are available as open source. But you have to compile them, you have to figure out how to install them and get everything put together into one convenient to use package. That's what we're doing with the AMI. You pull it in, you have access to TensorFlow, MXNet, Cafe, Theano, Torch. These are all the names, if you're in this space, you'll recognize these names. Installing all of those at once for you without you having to think about it, with all the device drivers for acceleration for the NVIDIA GPUs on our P2 instances in particular. So you have pre-built and optimized code that is incredibly easy to consume if you're doing detailed work on building new capabilities with deep learning and machine learning. I mentioned MXNet. This is an investment being made by AWS in particular. We think this is one of the best structured and most scalable deep learning packages. It's also a university-generated project out of CMU, Carnegie Mellon University in particular. We decided to invest in this project and help sponsor it to become an Apache incubator project. So it's really now Apache MXNet, and it makes it easy for us to combine it into Apache Hadoop and the entire EMR data science pipeline. So I think you'll see in the future the interfaces for making data scientists get into machine learning and deep learning. This will become easier and easier. But we're also seeing it used by people building self-driving cars, people doing image analysis, people doing speech analysis. It's a very powerful thing. However, to use it, you really need to be an expert. And it takes a long time to be really a deep expert in machine learning and deep learning. But we all use things that are complicated. Think about the smartphone in your pocket. If you give this to your 2-year-old child, your child can use a smartphone. They don't need to know how it works. They just need to understand what it can do, and they can find it very easy to use. So we want to make it so that everybody can use deep learning. And we've brought out 3 services which give you that capability. Recognition for image understanding and recognition, Poly for generating speech, and Lex, which is a conversational system which is basically the core of the Amazon Alexa product. You may have heard of the Alexa. It's a device that you, the Echo device in particular, something you may have in your kitchen. I have one in my kitchen. When I'm cooking, my hands are dirty, but I want to be able to ask questions, set timers, play music. I can do this by voice, by talking to my Alexa. We took the core of the Alexa, you drop the A at the beginning and the end, and you have Lex. And there are many people now embedding the Alexa voice capability into other products, whether, you know, speakers for the home, or cars, or anywhere where you want to have conversational intelligence. So this brings powerful intelligence to all developers. They are building blocks you can use to construct your own intelligent applications. Recognition works like this. You say, here's a picture, and what you get back is a JSON object that tells you it's a car outside, it's daytime, it's a female smiling, she's wearing glasses. This just comes straight back to you in a fraction of a second. If you can do things like find out all the photographs in your photo library where somebody's eyes are closed, it will tell you that. You can find all pictures of yourself. You can train this to do anything you like, but it's pre-trained to understand the basic things you might want to see about people in particular, locations, and it's a really interesting capability. It's easy to use. You can feed a batch of pictures into it. You can get real-time results. As we use it, as it sees more pictures, it keeps getting better. Over time, we're retraining it, and we're feeding it more and more images, and it's getting better. And it's very low cost to use. Polly is a text-to-speech application. And you feed it text, and in this example we say the temperature in WA is 75°F. But that isn't the way you'd really want to say that. Polly understands the context of what's happening and how to say it better. So it would actually say the temperature in Washington is 75 degrees Fahrenheit. This is actually a nice day in Washington. It's pretty cold up there most of the time. So text goes in, lifelike speech comes out. And it's powered by deep learning. You use it, you can even go to the AWS console and just type text in and see what happens. You've got multiple languages, multiple voices within those languages. And it returns to you an MP3 that you can just play as many times as you want. So you pay once for the conversion, and for trying it out, it's just free to try. Lex is this conversational environment. What is the weather forecast? It recognizes that, looks up the weather forecast using a Lambda function, returns it will be sunny, and then speaks that back out. The difference that Lex has from the Alexa product is it also has text-based input. You can use it for chat automation. We have integration with Slack for chatbots, and with Twilio for talking to telco, doing telecommunications. You do integrated development in the console. You say, these are the things I'm expecting to hear. Give it examples. It will match things that aren't exactly the same. They trigger Lambda functions. You have multiple steps in your conversation. And there are standard things, like if you want to input date, time, location, those are built-ins. It knows many, many different ways you might want to specify that. And then there are these enterprise connectors to things like Salesforce, Twilio, or Slack. It's fully managed. And this is generally available today. We announced the preview version in the summit in San Francisco and in reInvent, and today in San Francisco, earlier today, we announced that this is now generally available. So we have these capabilities, but what could you build on top of this? Some of our customers were saying, can we figure out how to build this into our call center applications? And we said, we'll go better than that. We'll build a call center for you. And I want to talk a little bit about Amazon Connect. So this was announced a few weeks ago. Right now it's only available really in English, so not so useful for the Korean market, but I think it's a great example of two things. One is what we can build on top of these intelligent services. And second, how AWS takes an existing product or capability, like a call center, and makes it extremely easy to use and extremely easy to pay for. You pay by the minute, and you build your environment in minutes. You don't have to go and have a commercial relationship with a call center company and have all of the time and cost that that would take. It means that small companies and individuals can set up call centers. You pay for the number of minutes that a customer is connected to your call center. That's all. Pay as you go. It automatically scales. There's no commitments, no hassle, and it has a telephony backend. It is an incredibly powerful system that's available to anybody now. So, we have a whole lot of customers achieving precognition with us. I'm going to talk a little bit about Yuanta Securities. It's a Korea-based financial service provider specializing in the security center. Tasks that used to take 2 hours now only take 30 minutes. And this is really useful for finding promising stocks and doing quantitative analysis. Now I'm going to bring up Colon Global. And they're going to talk about building a smart home on AWS. So please welcome Mr. Chung Hong Huan, Vice President of Colon Global. Thank you.
Hello. 반갑습니다. 저는 코론 글로벌의 정공환 상무라고 합니다. 먼저 저희 회사를 소개해드리겠습니다. 코론 글로벌은 건설, 유통, 무역, 헬스케어 4개 영역의 사업으로 구성이 되어 있습니다. 그 중에서 저는 건설 부문, 건축 사업 관리와 신사업을 담당하고 있습니다. 빠르게 변화하는 현세에 많은 기업들, 아니 대부분의 기업들이 미래 먹거리, 신사업에 대해서 고민하고 있으리라 생각합니다. 저희 회사도 많은 고민을 하고 있습니다. 특히 제가 담당하고 있는 주거 분야 굉장히 절실합니다. 그래서 저희는 작년 말 신개념의 주택임대사업을 커먼 라이프라는 브랜드로 런칭을 하였습니다. 이 커먼 라이프의 핵심 요소 중에 하나인 홈 IoT 플랫폼을 AWS와 함께 구축을 하였습니다. 오늘 이 두 분야의 협업 이야기를 말씀을 드리겠습니다. 지금 보시는 자료는 통계청 자료입니다. 좌측에 보시는 자료는 가구당 인원수의 변화 추이를 나타내는 자료입니다. 즉, 1, 2인 가구는 빠른 속도로 증가하고 있고 반면 우리의 전통적인 3, 4인 가구는 줄어든다는 것을 알 수 있습니다. 그리고 오른쪽에 보시는 자료는 거주의 형태의 변화를 나타내는 자료입니다. 역시 자가 소유보다는 이제는 임대 쪽으로 많이 이동하고 있다는 것을 알 수 있습니다. 이 두 가지 요소는 주택에 대한 인식이 강한 소유에서 이제는 거주의 개념으로 이동을 하고 있다라는 것을 알 수 있습니다. 말씀드린 두 가지 요인은 향후 거주주택에 두 가지 요소를 요구하고 또 영향을 미친다고 생각을 합니다. 첫째는 하드적인 요소로 다운사이징입니다. 두 번째는 소프트적인 요소로 많은 콘텐츠를 요구한다는 것입니다. 오늘은 이 콘텐츠 중심으로 말씀을 드리겠습니다. 비록 내가 사적으로 거주하는 공간은 작고 좁지만 내가 기거하는 건축물에는 카페와 같은 분위기에서 커피를 마실 수 있는 어떤 공간, 도서관과 같은 분위기에서 책을 볼 수 있는 공간, 입주민과 함께 취미생활을 할 수 있는 공간 등등 프로그램이 있는 공간을 요구한다는 것입니다. 커먼 라이프는 이러한 모든 것을 담은 신개념의 주택 임대 브랜드입니다. 커먼 라이프가 제시하는 상품의 서비스에는 매력적인 개인 공간과 다 함께 코리빙 할 수 있는 공유 공간, 그리고 입주민과 함께 소통하며 성장할 수 있는 커뮤니티 프로그램, 입주민 관리 서비스가 있습니다. 이러한 서비스는 모바일을 통한 제어가 가능하고 또한 홈 IoT 플랫폼을 통해서 유기적으로 활용이 됩니다. 커먼 라이프는 이 홈 IoT 플랫폼을 AWS 서비스를 이용하여 자체적으로 개발을 하였습니다. 저희가 자체적으로 개발을 한 이유는 사업을 추진할 시에 시중에 많은 IoT 기기들이 출시되어 있었습니다. 하지만 IoT 서비스 측면에서 볼 때 이 디바이스를 단순히 제어하는 기능에 국한된 경우가 많았습니다. 커먼 라이프가 추구하는 차별화된 서비스를 제공하기에는 적합하지 않았습니다. 저희가 추구하는 서비스는 스마트 홈 플러스 부킹, 매니지먼트, 멤버십 등 여러 가지를 아우를 수 있는 통합 서비스를 제공하기를 원했던 것입니다. 저희 회사는 전문 IT 기업이 아닙니다. 건설업을 주로 하는 기업입니다. 저희가 자체적으로 IoT 인프라 기반을 구축하기에는 사실상 어렵습니다. 비용적인 측면, 시간적인 측면, 그리고 인적 자원 측면 모두 제한적이었습니다. 그래서 저희는 그 대안으로 웹 서비스와 클라우드 서비스를 검토하고 찾게 되었습니다. 그 결과 IoT 서비스 시스템이 가장 잘 구축이 되어 있고 웹 서비스의 선도 업체인 AWS를 선택하게 되었습니다. 향후 커먼 라이프는 AWS와 함께 홈 IoT 플랫폼을 지속적으로 업데이트하고 진화시켜 나갈 것입니다. 아울러 이 쌓여진 빅데이터와 AI를 이용하여 홈 IoT 자율 서비스를 통한 최적화된 고객 맞춤형 서비스를 제공하겠습니다. 감사합니다.
Thank you, Mr. Chung. Interesting case here for using IoT and Alexa-based smart home platform. It's really, I'm looking forward to upgrading my house with some of these services. So we've been talking about some really advanced features, deep learning, machine learning, IoT in the home. This is where we're going. This is the next generation of applications. But many of you are probably thinking, well, yes, but in reality, in my world, I'm dealing with legacy applications. I'm stuck trying to upgrade things. I'm stuck with legacy vendors. So we need to give you some different kind of help. And what I'd like to give you now is the superpower, the power of flight, the ability to fly away from your legacy and your lock-in. We're going to give you the freedom to escape. In particular, many of our customers are telling us that they are trapped in their old world databases. They're very expensive, they're proprietary, they're locked in, the licensing costs are punitive, and the only time they see the salespeople is when they come to see and to audit them to make more money. This is just not a nice place to be. And what we're finding is customers really want to move to open source databases, MySQL, Postgres, and MariaDB. So we made a tool and a capability to help, the database migration service. It migrates between on-premise and AWS. It gives you the ability to migrate between databases automated schema conversion and data replication so that you can do continuous migration as you're bringing up the new system with the traffic going to the old system. It will continuously copy changes until finally you switch your traffic to the new system. We've migrated over 22,000 databases using this service over the last year or two. Now, as well as just transferring your capacity over to MySQL or Postgres, we wanted to give you the capability to run much larger workloads. Customers were saying, we need a more performant, more available, easier to run capacity. So we came out with Aurora. This gives you the speed and availability of these high-end commercial databases that you're locked into, with the cost-effectiveness of open source and the freedom, once you're moved onto a standard schema like MySQL, to move to anywhere you like. We have up to 5 times the performance of a typical MySQL server that you'd run yourself, a high-end one. It's highly available and durable with all of the data spread across 3 availability zones. We take care of any failover or any disaster recovery capabilities for you. It's a tenth of the cost of commercial-grade databases, and it's the fastest-growing AWS service we've ever released. We've also found that people were telling us, MySQL is great, but some of our databases, it would be easier if we could move the schema to Postgres. So we've been working really hard to bring out Amazon Aurora for Postgres, and we're excited to announce that this is now available as preview today. This was announced at the summit in San Francisco. Again, the same capacity and capabilities that you'd expect from an Aurora system, but with a Postgres front end for great compatibility with a much broader range of applications. We have many customers who have been using this with us to migrate their applications from old systems to the new databases. And in particular, I'd like to talk about Jeju Air, Korea's leading low-cost carrier. They're using Aurora to help the company ensure service availability even when there's a surge in user traffic. They're able to scale out their infrastructure with pay-as-you-go pricing. I'd also like to talk about Expedia. I've spent quite a lot of time working with them in the last few months. They have a database which stores the hotel pricing information for all of the properties around the world that generates trends and gives you suggestions in real time. You can go and figure out, I want to stay in some particular location, and it will tell you all of the hotels that are available. They used to run this on a commercial database vendor, and we've migrated this across to AWS on Aurora. It gives them the ability to analyze historic trends and do future promotions. They're uploading 300 million rows of data every day with 70,000 rows per second at peak. It takes 30 milliseconds to upload the data, to upload a row, and only 17 milliseconds to generate a response. It's a complex query which they're using to serve a customer's inquiry. Very high performance and very cost effective. The next thing I'm going to talk about is invisibility. With things like Athena, we make the data store invisible, the database invisible. You just say, here's my question, there's my data. We don't have to think about what's in between. But we have many capabilities here where we want to take away the things you shouldn't have to think about and make them invisible. In particular, virtual machines. Virtual machines in the cloud make the data center invisible. You stop thinking about it. The containers let you stop thinking about all the machines you're building, and serverless applications let you stop thinking about anything except, here's my code, I'd like it to run. So let's look at virtual machines. We have a really strong ecosystem built around our virtual machines. We have ELBs for load balancing, bringing traffic in, virtual private cloud for creating network structures, auto scaling for adding automatically growing and shrinking your collection of instances, RDS for the database, automatically provisioning databases, and EBS for creating data, adding data volumes and adding capacity to instances. On the container side, there are challenges. This is a relatively new capability. You have to manage your containers, you have to integrate a development pipeline, you have to give them resource access, security, service discovery, and high availability. There's a lot of challenges here. And we've built the EC2 container service to solve these challenges for you. This is a service that works so well that we don't really hear people talking about ECS very much, but we have a lot of customers using it. You just move on, this becomes invisible, and you think about some other problem in your application. This gives you cluster management, container orchestration, and deep integration with AWS. Let's look at the deep integration in particular. You have instance auto-scaling, so as you send more traffic to your containers, the underlying pool of instances that's running them grows and shrinks to make sure you always have very high utilization and extremely low cost. We have container auto-scaling, so when traffic hits a particular type of container, that container can grow and shrink in seconds, whereas instances, it takes minutes to grow and shrink. The ELB, the load balancer, reaches all the way to the container. We have identity and access management, so an individual container can be in a certain role where it's the only thing it's allowed to do. You can give it permission in that role to have keys that will let it read and write from a certain data store, but other containers on the same instance will have a different role for different permissions, and you can subdivide your security policies correctly into your container ecosystem. This is very hard to do, and it's a key advantage of the ECS system. I will talk a little bit about X-Ray in a minute. This is for monitoring containers. Finally, let's talk about serverless. AWS Lambda is our serverless platform. We released this almost 2 years ago, and initially I think people were confused. They weren't sure what it was for. But over time, we found more and more people using Lambda. You just saw the previous speaker, Colon, with a serverless architecture for IoT. It's extremely popular. What we're finding is customers are able to build applications extremely quickly, many times faster than with other ways of building applications that scale infinitely and at 100% utilization. So it's extremely low cost, very scalable, very fast to build. And this is why it's becoming extremely important. Here's the state of AWS Lambda. I won't go through everything, but the idea here is it connects to all our services and APIs. And it supports 4 different languages today, Node, Java, Python, and C#. We've recently added support for more versions of Node and Python. This lets customers achieve massive scale really easily. For example, Expedia runs 1.2 billion Lambda requests every month in production. You can use this to build applications, but you can also use it as an extensibility mechanism to help automate the way you run your AWS accounts. In particular, when your autoscaler is creating and destroying instances to maintain really high utilization, you can attach a Lambda function to this event so that after the autoscaler decides, I'm going to remove a machine because it's become idle, you can have a Lambda function that will wake up and clean up something, or you could have it be invoked when you first create a function, create a new instance. So you can do trigger-driven automation around all of the things that are happening in your AWS account. Lambda is also an extensibility mechanism for many of our capabilities. The Lex product, the Alexa skills that people build that teach you new ways of interacting with voice products, those are built as Lambda functions. Greengrass is a mechanism for embedding Lambda in IoT devices, whether industrial devices, cars, or your phone, anything you want, in a smartphone application. Snowball Edge is a new product that we announced last December. Think of it as a tiny AWS region in a ruggedized box. It weighs around 20 kilograms. You could carry it. You plug it in, and it has 100 terabytes of disk and an EC2 instance inside it. You program it with Lambda. This is becoming very interesting, particularly in areas where there's a huge amount of video data being produced in the field. We've seen applications in commercial drone inspection. Now, if you're inspecting cell towers with a drone, you're generating huge amounts of video. That video needs to be stored somewhere securely and then transported back to AWS for processing. So it's a really interesting product. I think this is the beginning of a range of products, something to watch for. The other place that we're putting Lambda is at the edge. The CloudFront CDN lets you do low latency request responses to your customers. We put them out in many more locations. When you load a Lambda function into Edge, it goes everywhere in the world. And it's just a few milliseconds away from all the major population areas that your customers could be in. So this gives you the ability to take Lambda as a new capability, a new architecture for building extremely distributed applications. I'm fascinated to see what everyone builds with these products, with Lambda and what products you build. Now, as you build more complex applications with Lambda, you have to figure out how to sequence things and how to invoke chains of functions. So you have to turn it into applications. And we're finding that there are many different ways that people want to do that. And we've built a tool that helps you build complex orchestrations of these functions. We call this AWS Step Functions. It's a coordinated, stateful way to organize your Lambda operations. You can scale out. It helps you keep state. It does error handling for you, and it operates everything, and it gives you an audit log so that you can see exactly what your application's doing. So what we've built on AWS is first-class primitives for virtual machines, containers, and serverless with really deep integration into the rest of our ecosystem and the capabilities that our customers want around security, audit, identity, and all of the automation required so you don't have to think about these things and they become invisible for you. Now, when you're building applications, you need deep insight into how your applications are behaving. So let's look a little bit at X-Ray. This is a new service, and I'm excited to announce it's generally available as of today and the SF Summit and also in the Seoul region. So very happy to say that you have it locally. What does this do? So this is the architecture of your application. X-Ray will produce a diagram that looks like this for you. Clients come in, they access a front-end load balancer, and the traffic flows through the system. It tags every request that flows through, and you get a tree of requests so that you can see exactly where you are slow. In this case, it's showing that DynamoDB is set up with too low a level and it's throttling the application, so it's causing slowness further up the application. Now you look at your application and say, okay, I know exactly where the problem is, I can go and increase the throttle on DynamoDB and then my application will be performing correctly. So this is application performance monitoring as a capability deeply embedded into the AWS capabilities. We also announced the preview of X-Ray for Lambda. So now you can see the invocations of your Lambda functions combined with all of the other services. This goes deeply into our services. Our services are being instrumented with X-Ray. And if you look at your existing tools vendors, the APM tools vendors in this space, this is something they cannot do. They cannot instrument all the way into, deeply into AWS. But X-Ray has an API which the tools vendors are using to pull information out of X-Ray and combine it with all the other data and all the other services that you've used. So we're using this to power our partners in the APM and performance monitoring space with a new data source, which gives them great capabilities for making a much deeper integration with AWS. So, we have many customers who have achieved invisibility and we've helped automate them. For example, Thomson Reuters, in only 2.5 months, they built a serverless application pipeline for analytics, which processes over 4,000 requests a second. It gives them the ability to go from event capture to a chart display in less than 10 seconds. Now I'm going to introduce Samsung, which I'm sure you're very familiar with. They have been adopting a microservice architecture on ECS, and please welcome Mr. Chang Soo Baek, Vice President of Samsung Electronics.
Hello, 저는 삼성전자 무선 사업부에 근무하고 있는 장수백입니다. 저는 오늘 여러분께 삼성 커넥트에 대해 소개해 드리려고 합니다. 지난달 언팩 행사에서 미리 보신 분들도 있으시겠지만 저희 삼성 커넥트는 IoT, 사물 인터넷의 기기들을 관리할 수 있는 서비스입니다. 먼저 동영상을 잠시 보시겠습니다. 사물 인터넷에서 가장 대표적인 것들이 저희 일상생활 속에 있는 가전제품들입니다. 삼성 커넥트를 통해서 TV 같은 것들은 리모컨과 같이 TV 리모컨과 똑같은 기능들을 그대로 제어하실 수 있습니다. 그리고 세탁기와 건조기, 냉장고와 같은 다른 가전제품들 또한 각각의 기능들을 제어하실 수 있게 해드립니다. 많은 기기들을 하나씩 작동해야 한다면 전구도 하나씩 켜고 끄고 그리고 TV와 오디오 같은 것들도 하나하나씩 작동하여야 한다면 불편하시겠죠? 저희 삼성 커넥트는 여러분들이 원하시는 기기들을 보다 쉽게 작동할 수 있도록 도와드립니다. 위 네 개의 아이콘처럼 집을 나설 때나 혹은 청소를 할 때나 그리고 잠을 잘 때나 또는 영화를 보려고 하실 때 그러한 여러 가지 모드들을 제공해드리면서 그 모드 안에서 여러 가지 기기들을 하나의 버튼으로 제어하실 수 있게 해드립니다. 또한 이런 모드는 여러분들이 직접 만드실 수도 있습니다. 시간에 따른 자동 제어를 하시든지 아니면 모션 센서에 따라서 자동 제어도 가능합니다. 어느 장소의 기기들을 요일이나 시간에 따라서 혹은 모션 센서에 따라서 작동하실지를 선택의 여지를 드림으로써 여러분들이 직접 사물 인터넷을 관리하시고 제어하실 수 있습니다. 삼성 커넥트는 저희 가전제품 외에도 스마트띵스가 작동하는 허브, 아울렛, 그리고 많은 종류의 센서들을 지원합니다. 삼성 커넥트가 지원하는 이 수많은 기기들을 제어함으로써 여러분의 집을 좀 더 똑똑히 만들어 보시는 건 어떨까요? 보시기에는 간단한 어플리케이션처럼 보일 수 있지만 저희는 삼성 커넥트를 지원하기 위해 커다란 시스템을 구축을 했습니다. 수많은 단말, 그리고 그보다 더 많은 사물 인터넷 기기들을 지원해야 하며 세상의 많은 국가들을 또 지원해야 합니다. 또한 보안과 안전성, 효율적인 자원을 활용해야 하며 60개가 넘는 어플리케이션들을 4개의 다른 지역의 개발자들과 함께 일을 했습니다. 이러한 것들을 극복하기 위해 오로스케일링의 적용, 아키텍처의 재정비, 각 지역에서의 분산된 개발, 그리고 자동화되고 독립적인 배포를 하게 했으며 다양한 서비스에 최적화할 수 있는 인스턴스 타입들을 적용함으로써 아마존에서의 마이크로 서비스 아키텍처를 구현하였습니다. 저희 아키텍처는 셀 아키텍처라고 보실 수 있습니다. IoT가 가져야 하는 빌딩 블록들을 마이크로 서비스로 만들므로써 bounded context, 즉 경계가 있는 컨텍스의 개념을 적용하여 분리되었지만 세포와 같이 자유롭게 작동할 수 있도록 만들었습니다. 이렇게 만든 시스템을 네 개의 지역에 각각 배포를 하고 이 모든 것들을 관장할 수 있는 글로벌 레이어를 두어 필요한 데이터를 레플리케이트 할 수 있도록 하였습니다. 아키텍처를 좀 더 자세히 보면 ELB를 통해서 들어오는 리퀘스트를 분산을 하고 그리고 클라우드 워치를 통해서 매트릭스를 통해 그거에 대한 오로 스케일링을 적용을 하였습니다. 다른 마이크로 서비스가 처리하는 분산되는 데이터들을 다이나모DB나 아로라에 적용을 했고요. 그리고 이벤트 파이프라인이 프로세스하는 로그 파일들을 S3에 넣었습니다. 그리고 third-party 클라우드와의 연동을 위해 API 게이트웨이와 람다를 이용하였습니다. 오로 스케일링에 대해서 좀 더 말씀을 드리면 두 가지의 오로 스케일링을 적용을 했습니다. 클라우드 워치를 통해서 EC2에 대한 오로 스케일링을 적용을 했고 그럼으로써 ECS가 필요한 클러스터링에 대한 확보를 하였습니다. 그리고 ECS에서 다시 또 한 번의 오로 스케일링을 하여 필요한 마이크로소프트 서비스들을 어베일리비티 존에 하여 가용성을 높였습니다. 삼성 커넥트의 다음 단계는 이렇습니다. 더 많은 기기와 서비스들을 연결하면서 더 많은 트래픽을 안정적이고 효율적으로 처리하는 발전을 할 것이고 이렇게 모여진 데이터를 빅데이터로 분석하여 사용자들에게 더 지능적이고 편한 서비스를 제공할 것입니다. 그리고 개발자와 협력사들에게 보다 편리하게 그들의 어플리케이션과 기기를 사용자에게 제공할 수 있도록 하실 것입니다. 여러분들은 IoT를 하면 무엇이 생각나시나요? 저는 디지털 레인이 생각납니다. 숫자가 비처럼 내려오는 이런 장면들을 영화 속에서 보셨을 겁니다. IoT는 그런 숫자를 내리는 비입니다. 때로는 수증기처럼 눈에 보이지 않지만 이제 어느 순간에 저희의 주위를 가득 채우고 있습니다. 그런 비를 풍성하게 해줄 수 있는 것이 바로 구름, 클라우드입니다. 아마존의 튼튼한 클라우드 그리고 그 위에 삼성 커넥트를 통해 여러분들이 풍부한 IoT를 경험해 보시길 바랍니다. 감사합니다.
Thank you very much. So now I'm going to talk about the ability to keep you safe. You need a force field to protect your infrastructure and your applications. And we'll talk about the security tools that AWS brings you. We have some tools that are networking focused. We have really useful encryption capabilities which let you meet compliance and protect your data. Identity is really important. We need to know who is doing what role they're in, and what they should be able to do. And then we have compliance tools. This gives you a service catalog, the ability to generate an audit trail of everything that happens in your AWS accounts, and the ability to control the configuration with policy and to have rules for who is allowed to do what, depending on what role they're in. This is, you know, very important in highly regulated industries, and we have a lot of customers using these capabilities. Protecting your customers and your business is priority number one for AWS. We have built-in security by design, many capabilities like the Cloud Hardware Security Module for protecting your keys, and CloudTrail for tracking everything that's happened. And automation is really important. There's a partnership between AWS and the developer in order to build a secure application. And we have a lot of education and a lot of capabilities here, which we want to work with you to develop as we explore new markets and as we take on bigger challenges together. However, there is one particular threat that customers worry about, and that is distributed denial of service. For many years, we've actually been protecting our customers from distributed and out of service attacks. It was just built into AWS. It was never even a feature that we gave a name to. Last December, we decided we needed to give it a name and provide a more advanced version of it. So the base product, which we've had for a long time, we do for everybody, is called AWS Shield for Everyone. It gives you protection from volumetric and state exhaustion attacks. The advanced product that we announced last December is quite interesting, though. It gives you additional protection against more larger and more sophisticated attacks, and it meets the needs of our larger, more enterprise-oriented customers. You have notifications via CloudWatch that a DDoS attack is happening. We give you cost protection. What would that mean? Cost protection means that, let's say your normal traffic is at some level, but during a denial of service attack, 10 times the traffic is going to hit you for a whole day. Some of the services which are being hit might cause an increased charge to you, like the load balancer, CloudFront, or Route 53. But during the time that we identify that a DDoS attack is happening, we zero out those extra costs. So that is cost protection. During the attack, all the extra traffic that's generated will be no cost to you because we've identified that it's not your fault. It's nothing to do with you. We are trying to protect you from these attacks. We have 24/7 response team and support to give you somebody to talk to about how it's affecting your application and how we're going to work around things. And we also include the web application firewall at no additional cost. This is a product which gives you the ability to filter at the HTTP level rather than more at the network level. In the security space, we've got a lot of work going on with many financial institutions around the world. But one of them, Capital One, I've been working with closely for the last 3 or 4 years. They want to be the Netflix of the financial industry, and that was why I was talking to them. What did they mean by that? They wanted to be one of the first customers on AWS to push a bank onto the public cloud with AWS, to take everything onto everything, to define what is needed to run a bank on AWS and work with AWS to develop those capabilities. They are API driven, they are agile, they are doing DevOps practices, and they are automating everything they do with a view to being a leader in this space. They transformed themselves to a really agile organization using AWS and chose AWS as their predominant cloud provider. They're migrating core banking systems and customer-facing applications to AWS and closing most of their data centers over the next few years. We've worked with them to give them velocity, elasticity, availability, and a great pace of innovation. But most importantly, we've worked with them to define the security patterns required to run financial services on AWS. And those patterns have been documented and shared so that other banks and other financial institutions who are moving to AWS but maybe have not got quite as far as Capital One, we're sharing across everybody and we're building out the compliance and the auditing capabilities that are needed in this space. Trusting AWS with security frees Capital One engineers to focus on building innovative banking products. We do the heavy lifting for them. In the Korean financial industry, Mirae Asset Global Investments made this statement. We feel AWS Cloud is stronger and more stable than our own data center. And our website is secure against DDoS attack because it's behind the Amazon CloudFront CDN. So in conclusion, what we really want to get is immortality. We want our companies and our enterprises to be long-lived. The organizations in this room, organizations using AWS, these are the organizations who are going to survive in the competitive environment that we live in today globally. Using all these superpowers and harnessing the benefits of the cloud is going to give you some immortality. Startups are breathing new life into virtual every industry. SaaS companies are breathing new life into virtually every industry as well. And enterprises are transforming themselves onto AWS. Just everyone has figured out they need to evolve their technology quickly to survive long term. Many organizations are building systems of engagement. What we had in the past, enterprises had to build applications to serve their customers and their manufacturing, and this was most of their IT needs, to serve their employees and their manufacturing. And their customers were a small part of their IT needs. Nowadays, the interface to your customers and the connections to your products through IoT and through digital marketing are the dominant capacity drivers in IT. This is evolving so fast that every enterprise now has to learn to be an agile software-based business, regardless of what they're building and what market they're in. So today, we have 48 technical sessions today. You can learn and you can go build. We have over 30 customer sessions on day one and day two from all of the customers you see listed here. So please learn and go build and have a great time at the rest of today. Thank you. And Gamsa Hamnida. Hopefully I said that right. Thank you.